इस आजादी के अमृत महोत्सव पर जो हम लोग संस्थान हमारे परिषद की तरफ से 75 लेक्चर सीरीज ऑर्गेनाइज कर रहे हैं, इसमें सभी का स्वागत करता हूं। मैं डॉक्टर माई साहब का बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करता हूं कि उन्होंने हमारा ये निमंत्रण स्वीकार किया इस लेक्चर को देने के लिए बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक पर। और आज का जो एक टॉपिक है ये है टैलेंट सर्च फॉर मैनिंग एग्रीकल्चर ट्री, और ट्री का बहुत अच्छा एक्सपेंशन डॉक्टर माई साहब ने किया है, टीचिंग रिसर्च एंड एक्सटेंशन एजुकेशन। और ये ट्री, वैसे भी हम लोग ट्री पर बहुत ध्यान देते हैं, और ये वाले जो ट्री है इस पर भी हमें आज माई साहब बहुत अच्छा विचार व्यक्त करेंगे अपना, कि किस तरह से हमें अपना टैलेंट सर्च को इम्प्रूव करना चाहिए। साथियों, मैं बताना चाहूँगा कि ये जो हमारा लेक्चर सीरीज है ये बहुत महत्वपूर्ण लेक्चर सीरीज है, और अभी तक बहुत महत्वपूर्ण लोगों ने अपने विचार इसमें रखे हैं। इसमें कई तरह के टॉपिक्स पर हमारे लेक्चर्स हुए हैं, जैसे कि कृषि पॉलिसी से संबंधित, हमारे जो विभिन्न तकनीकियां हैं, शोध हैं, अनुसंधान है, इन सब के ऊपर टॉपिक्स हुए हैं, और मोटिवेशनल एस्पेक्ट्स पर भी हुए हैं, कोविड पर भी कुछ लेक्चर्स हुए हैं। और ये आज का लेक्चर हमारा लेक्चर नंबर 35 है, कुल हमें 75 लेक्चर्स करवाने हैं, तो करीब करीब हम लोग मध्य में पहुंच चुके हैं इस लेक्चर सीरीज के में। डॉक्टर माई साहब का भी जो टॉपिक है जो मैंने अभी बताया, आज बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट टॉपिक है हम सभी के लिए। मैं हालांकि डॉक्टर माई साहब एक बहुत ही वेल नोन फिगर हैं, हम सभी माई साहब को बहुत अच्छी तरह से जानते हैं और सभी भली भांत परिचित हैं उनसे, लेकिन फिर भी मैं आपकी याददाश्त को थोड़ा ताज़ा करने के लिए मैं उनके बायोडाटा के बारे में, मैं उनके एक जीवन परिचय डॉक्टर माई साहब का देने का आपसे प्रार्थना करता हूँ। डॉक्टर सी डी माई इज ए रिनाउंड कॉटन साइंटिस्ट एंड इज करेंटली सर्विंग एज द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ द साउथ एशिया बायोटेक्नोलॉजी सेंटर न्यू दिल्ली एंड चेयरमैन ऑफ AFC इंडिया लिमिटेड, फॉर्मरली एग्रीकल्चरल फाइनेंस कॉर्पोरेशन ऑफ इंडिया मुंबई। बॉर्न इन फार्मिंग फैमिली ऑफ महाराष्ट्र, डॉक्टर माई ऑब्टेन्ड हिज एग्रीकल्चर डिग्रीज फ्रॉम महाराष्ट्र एंड PhD फ्रॉम IARI इन प्लांट पैथोलॉजी। ही कमेंस्ड हिज करियर इन प्लांट पैथोलॉजी रिसर्च एट IARI एंड कैपेसिटीज एट सेंट्रल राइस रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट कटक, पंजाब एग्रीकल्चर यूनिवर्सिटी लुधियाना, द फोर्ड फाउंडेशन दिल्ली एंड महाराष्ट्र एग्रीकल्चर यूनिवर्सिटी परवनी फॉर नियरली 30 years. The research, teaching and extension experience led him to work as Vice Chancellor MAU Parvani, Director Central Institute for Cotton Research Nagpur and Agriculture Commissioner, very prestigious assignment, Government of India, before retiring as the Chairman of Agriculture Scientist Recruitment Board in our ministry there. Though specialized in plant pathology, Dr. Mai committed himself for the growth of Indian agriculture. He guided 20 PhD and more than 38 MSc students, wrote books and monographs, published over 200 scientific publications in journals of repute, and served the cause through development of the subject. He was elected as fellow member of several scientific committees and associations, including vice president of National Academy of Agriculture Sciences, one of the most prestigious academy in the country, and also invited as member of international societies, including ISAAA and ABNE Africa. During his scientific, he promoted the production technologies of cotton, groundnut, sunflower, and coarse cereals. Biotechnology is his passion, and he was associated with his commercial release of BT cotton in India from time of conduct of biosafety and bioefficiency evaluation till released by the GEAC. He developed biotech infrastructure in Nagpur and Parbhani and has organized the International Cotton Genomic Initiative Conference and the 5th World Cotton Research Congress in Mumbai. Dr. Mai has been Alexander Humboldt Fellow of Germany. He is recipient of several honors and awards for agriculture development, including the Lifetime Achievement Awards and Honorary Doctors of Philosophy from many universities. Currently, Dr. Mai is member of Board of Management of many organizations and universities. Dr. Mai Saab, I would like to inform you that today's lecture is being attended by a large number of participants. You can see 171, which include the vice chancellors, which include directors, and which includes our many senior persons from the ICR, from NAS Academy, from universities, the deans, directors, many more persons. And it is also being live streamed to be seen at the Facebook, at the YouTube, and it is being live streamed at our own customized website, icr75lectureseries.webcomevents.com. So many more persons, they are connected through that site also. And I'm requesting Dr. Mohapatra, our Director General of ICR and Secretary Dare, to chair this session. So thank you, sir, for agreeing for chairing this important session. And I want, Chairman sir, your permission to request Dr. Mai to take the floor and start his lecture. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Over to you, Dr. Mai. Thank you very much. First of all, let me thank respected Dr. Mahapatra ji, that who has considered me worthy of being one of the speakers, one of the Azadi Ka Amrut Mahotsav lecture series. And I really thank him for this, and also thank ICAR. I am very happy to say that the program which ICAR has really started, it has a lot of implications, what I find, because they are covering in these 75 lectures, I think, the total scenario of agriculture of India. And I therefore would like to really congratulate the organizers and ICAR for wonderful job that they have really done. I am today talking about...
Sorry, sir, I interrupt you, sir. Please share a screen, sir.
Can I share the screen? Okay, are you able to see everybody?
Yes, sir, please go ahead.
Azadi Ka Amrut Mahotsav, I wish, first of all, wishing all the stakeholders of agriculture a successful celebration of India at 75. Let me tell you that the talk, which is basically related to what we call it as talent search, because I was almost for 6.5 years working as chairman of Agriculture Scientist Recruitment Board, and I felt that the most important, because we organized an international conference on talent search for the first time. And then we learned lots of lessons from United States, Europe, Japan. Many people came, and also some of the organizations within our own country, like DR, like CSIR, we all came together to find out, because in science, it is the most important part is to have really what we call it as the talent search for manning everything. And in ICAR, fortunately, we have three functions. What we call it as education, then research, and also extension education. So therefore, I call this as a talent search for the entire tree. For getting talent, the most important factor is education. I think, and therefore, I think I must thank Dr. Agarwal, who is heading that particular division now. This is the pillar for getting talent search. Now, if I say, what is education? It is a comprehensive, holistic, all-compassing endeavor. And this, basically, one is able to embark on the journey of what is called as a self-development and fulfillment. Now, if we look up to agriculture education, what it has proved, it is really wonderful. It can help in economic growth. It has already helped. Remove inequality, poverty, hunger, rural development, reduce migration from urban areas to rural areas to urban areas, induce in probing nuances of agriculture science, and it also helps sacrificing through extension. Because there are hundreds of cases where we find that our scientists have really sacrificed through extension work. Now, every institute has basically three functions. What we call it as a vision or a mission. It has a goal, objectives. The achievements are based on the tripods. And that tripod is, it should have a clarity, It should have a commitment, that is devotion and passion, and it must have a capability, that is skill and development. I think if we see the foundations of agriculture education in India, which has been published many over years, I just like to just briefly say that before independence, we started the first education began in 1877 at Agri College, Saidapet. And then we established agriculture college at Kanpur, Lalpur. Now it is in Faisalabad, that is in Pakistan, Coimbatore, Pune, Nagpur, and then Sabor between 1905 and 1908. Now also we started veterinary diploma. Then it was basically at Pune, Bombay, Calcutta, Madras, Patna, and then established the most important is what today's IRA is Imperial Institute in Pusa. But after independence, government of India appointed what we called as an education commission, which was headed by Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. And he suggested establishment of rural universities. Actually, that was the time when the concept of agriculture university was generated. And then, of course, there was appointment of several joint Indo-American team and all that, which resulted in ultimately the formation of the system. Now, this National Agricultural Research System, what we normally refer as NARS, it is comprised of, it's one of the unique system in the world. ICAR, State Agricultural Universities, together, we normally form the NARS. This is the largest network of research, teaching, and extension in the world. Now, universities provide the requisite talents. That's why I said education. Now, universities are mandated for classical education, from where we get talents to man the entire system of teaching, research, extension, and even academic administration at all levels. Now, we have SAUs, that is state agriculture universities, deemed universities, central agriculture universities, central universities, are the main supplier of manpower to NARS. Now, if to some extent the traditional universities do now, they are also providing. Some private universities have also now created agriculture faculties. So let us see the current agriculture scenario is what we have. A very, very broad sort of canvas we have. NARS has done some very good work. GR, that is Green Revolution, plus excellent growth in food production, exploitation of newer technology. This is all combined effort of SAUs and ICAR system. Then we have now golden, white, blue, all revolutions combined together. Strong private sector was created. And we have also created close binding. This is the first time that we have a very good binding in the federal system with SAUs and ICAR without any formal statutes. This is one of the very surprising thing which we always say. Now, but we have also certain shortfalls which are occurring, like technology versus policy fatigue. Quality of education not resulting in producing highest standards of scientists, teachers, extension workers. Not so much made in basic and fundamental work. We are now not concentrating to that extent which is expected. The present day salary, promotion, recruitment provide really sometimes no incentive. Governance, still bureaucratic, and it is a CEO centered, which is a acceptable profile for any change. This is what we are very clear. Now, if we see ICAR, I think it is everybody knows it very well, that we have nearly 103 institutes. There are several regional structures, and there are several state agriculture universities. I think more than 63, this may be a little old data, because new universities have also been created, which probably Dr. Agrawal can update more. Like Central Agriculture Universities, we have now 3, which used to be earlier 1. But the most important part is what we call it as earlier, the whole concept of agriculture was a unification. We had, what we have is horticulture, veterinary, forestry, dairy, fisheries, engineering. They used to be all together. Over a period of time, every state universities have now created a different kind of a structure. So for example, there are only some universities which are still composite, but there are now only veterinary universities, only forestry universities, horticulture universities, dairy. So likewise, if you see, the structure is now changing depending on the gravity or what is the requirement of the child. Now, if you look into the spread of ICAR for these SAUs, you will be surprised that some of the states, like, say, for example, if you take Karnataka, where it has 6 universities. Now, if you say, is university, there is only one. So, variation between the states has become very large. Some of them are growing. Like, for example, Gujarat, continuously new kinds of universities. I was also surprised that they have a university called as Organic Agriculture University now. So, more specialization, more universities are coming into the floor. So, Maharashtra, we have 6 universities here from where I am sitting. So, lot of things which are now changing. So, that variation which is occurring because basically because agriculture becoming a state subject. Now, status of non-SAU affiliated colleges, all major states have brought under AU system. However, there are 50 colleges still in mostly UP, Rajasthan, where they are outside the SAU system. National Agriculture Commission actually had a review. Earlier also, it was a review done by ICAR, and they wanted to support this, giving some grants. However, during the 5th and 6th plan, 15 such colleges were supported. But over a period of time, I think they were not given any kind of grant. Even further committees, like even Swaminathan committee, suggested to bring them under SAU system for the purpose of admission, examination, evaluation. But still, they remain. For example, in UP, we have several universities, traditional, where agriculture college, Rajasthan is another, West Bengal, Punjab, Tamil Nadu, Pondicherry, Nagaland, Uttarakhand, AP, Goa. Now, these are those which are outside SAU system, SAU system. But now, within SAU system, if you see, Maharashtra is leading with more than 123 colleges under the, all these 4 universities. Chhattisgarh started several colleges, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh. Now, they are becoming part. So, most important part is, now there are private universities like Lovely Agriculture Professional University, Fagwada, Guru Kashi University, Swaminathan, MS Swaminathan Kut, Odisha, Shikshan Anusandhan, Odisha, Sharda University. So, I have just given you an example. There may be still more. But what I am finding is that education is spreading. And therefore, the talent search, what is most important part is, the major focus and objective of this effort is increasing target of growth rate require trained manpower for training. Develop NAR system for backstopping the national efforts. To address the challenges, ICAR fostered a countrywide arrangement with universities under that system to set aside 15% and 25% of our seat for the graduate and masters to be filled by the All India examination. This is a wonderful system. I think this is where ICAR has really has done a marvelous job in combining the university structure together so that they are automatically bound to ICAR system. All India competitive examination to award SRF is another way how the talent search is promoted for doctoral degree program. Then ICAR NTS at national level scholarship also support the talent for pursuing. So these are some of the efforts which I think in the far few years ICAR has initiated. And quality assurance is another very important part. It was started way back in 52. The education panel prescribed certain guidelines and the standing committee also developed a model act for that purpose. Norms and accreditation committee also developed norms for financial assistance. So accreditation ultimately board established in 96. It is restructured as now the entire national board in 2017. 4 regions to ensure quality. I think at this stage compliment ICAR because this is where I think we will have to bring quality assurance in education. If we want talent, sir, if we want equality to be brought about, every university should function, every university should participate and come to equal level. I think accreditation board, which is under the ICAR, is doing a very fantastic job in the last few years. I must compliment for that. Now, this Quality assurance accreditation is done to ensure quality in higher education in all SAUs and its constituent colleges also. The accreditation is made mandatory, indirectly. I would say that in other system, it is more voluntary. But here it is mandatory by linking grants in aid from ICAR. I think this is a indirect way of doing mandatory. Not only SAUs and their constituent colleges, but also CAUs, DUs, CUs, and all faculties of agriculture and allied branches of private university also has been brought in the fold of accreditation. I was just going through the report. I think details are of the a policy paper has been published by ICAR in March 21. Out of those who are interested in more details about this thing, quality assurance, they can look into this paper, which I Division of Education has. National level accreditation bodies, probably you are all aware that medical education is like MCI, veterinary education like VCI, National Accreditation Council for Humanities and other things, National Board of Accreditation is also for AICT education. Accreditation board now, but all these were rather, ours was more voluntary and others were basically mandatory. Now it is time. Can we think of making them more mandatory type? I think that is one. Now, what are the concerns? Concerns of education is horizontal expansion leading to dilution of efforts. I think this is a very important part because, okay, we can expand education, but not at the cost of quality. Some new institutions have been created, I find, in the last 10 years without any infrastructure for R&D. And agriculture, R&D is a component of your entire education, and that cannot be separated. Unfortunately, I find institutions are just created. Many private colleges, they do not really qualify to become, but since there has been, it is in the state subject, many of them are running without proper infrastructure. Many institutions are busy in changing tiles only of labs, but not the style of working. What I often say that we have to see the style of working change. Agriculture being a state subject, no uniformity in education, research, and extension. That probably exists. And none of the SAUs appear in general merit rank of educational institutions. I think this is like, I look into, if I say IRI in agriculture, I think some of the SAUs must actually qualify to become that level, like IITs, like IIMs. So some of them must reach up there. So this is one concern which we have. Human resource of scientists for R&D, every scientist has to perform triple functions. That is teaching, research, and extension. Now, ICR scientist strength is approximately, this may be needing some correction, but when I was there as a chairman, nearly 6,000 plus was the strength of ICAR. And it increased by 9.5% in the last 18 years. However, against this, at any given time, 22% vacancies exist. I find today the vacancy increased much more than 22%. Because I see a recent advertisement where there are more than, I think, 90 directors' positions have been vacant. This should not have happened. This should be a sort of a continuous process of filling. Otherwise, what happens is if there is no regular institution head, I think the institutions are little limping type. The vacancy has grown now. There are nearly 380 research managers position. I include everything where we have even project coordinators and all that in the country to manage 6,000 scientists. But currently out of this, 42 positions are vacant that time. Now today, as I see, they are more than that, maybe vacant about. The position of in SAU is still precarious. Now, the strength of 18,000 in 1991 reduced to 14,700. All the 72, 73 agricultural universities. The strength, in spite of the fact that we have increased number of universities, the strength has come down. Slightly increased now to 21,000 because of multiplication. The number of scientists and teachers per SAU has come down from 270 now, from earlier 426 two decades ago. I think this is also another very important part. These figures, I'm just giving you maybe latest, you will have to really go into more detail. But this is what is actually the scenario. Massive shift in the last 20 years towards creation of Krishi Vidyan Kendra, practically in each district, is a welcome phenomenon. But what happens is around 7,500 extension scientists are working in all those KVKs. This has been the result of a failure of traditional extension system. Now what is happening is that everybody is in extension in the state is dependent on KVK. And fortunately, ICAR has given massive support to these KVKs. Otherwise, I was really afraid because the state government is really not looking into traditional extension system which we have. Recruitment of manpower, I think now we all know the ICAR board is very clear. Agriculture Scientist Recruitment Board was formed with a mission to really provide scientific manpower to all ICAR institutions so as to achieve excellence. And it has a vision to develop most respectful, reliable, durable, independent system of scientific manpower provision in agriculture with true national character. That was the vision which we have. I think this the aims and objective of ARS was to foster, foster cooperation in place of unhealthy competition, enable scientists to get the highest possible salary within the system, promote interdisciplinary teamwork, promote horizontal and vertical mobility. That was what the aims and objective of ARS. De-glamorize management position and fill them on tenural basis. The recruitment through competitive examination followed by personal interview for entry level and recruitment by interview for lateral entry for two senior scientific and research management. One of the, I think, recruitment procedures which were established in ASRB, I must say that this is a very excellent system. Only thing is it has to be a very on fast board because once you remain silent for a longer time, then there are, because this is the range of annual range of recruitment used to be sometimes maybe about 7-8 years ago. For DDG, you have an annual range of almost 14 positions. Annual range is 0 to 3 every year. I have tried to understand from my own experience as a chairman, what is the annual range of recruitment in ELOL is this position. And once we understand this, I think it becomes more easy to really find out. For example, ARS vacancies, almost 150 to 350 ARS vacancies should be available annually. If I had to make those position of 3,800 available, I think this calculation back is very important. Another very important factor which I have noticed, and maybe I think the current ASRB must look into it, is the sort of from where does our manpower of ARS is coming? In the last, till I was in 2011, I just analyzed the data and I was surprised that IARI, IVRI, CIFE, NDRI, they are the most contributor to ARS system, followed by maybe TNAU, maybe Dharwad University, Agrawal. So out of all those, 70 to 80% which are coming from only certain universities or certain institutions will lose the national character in the long run. That is what I felt that time. Actually, trying to understand that how other universities can make it. For example, even the recruitment of ARS, you can find the ratio was almost 1:6.9. Earlier, it used to be 1.3. So if you advertise 170 posts, candidates interviewed 590, you will not get 1:5 ratio for even candidate calling for interview. So that appears to be again indicating what kind of quality education that we are able to university. This is now in the present. Even the, I think the last data which I have obtained, this is the latest data up to say 2016, which has, so they advertise 180 position, they have filled about 179, but the ratio available of 1:5 candidate has always been missing. Now this is another very important factor which is to be considered, is NET examination. Now NET has been made almost compulsory, in except a few where NET is not required, but they have their own system. But here also, I think what we need is, if we look into the overall percentage passing of NET has been substantially come down. Now this is what is has latest, which has appeared in 2019. Only 13 people qualified in NET 21. Which will be conducted in 60 discipline in future. Emerging concern, therefore, ARS at entry level for me, high degree of skewness in the performance of SAUs, which is creating what we call it as a regional imbalance. I already told them that there may be some states where they will be more represented, while there are some areas where there will be no people coming into the picture. Shortage of high-performing candidates in ARS. How to attract good talent, candidates, particularly in pure science and engineering branches. This is another very good concern which we felt that time, because the number of applicants used to be very low. Should the difference between the cutoff for reserve and general categories be reduced, as the difference in performance of general categories has been narrowed? This is the analysis which we did, and we find be a further improvement in this thing. Now, selection by interview. These are the positions which we normally go in for, either scientist, principal scientist, senior scientist, HOD, PC, ZC, maybe that time it used to be. Now it is director, director, ADG, JD, national director, and DDG. These are the positions which are filled. And then we try to manipulate now these attributes. There are several committees. Now I was told that there is recently another committee where the weightages are given to these attributes. Academic qualification, service, relevant experience, externally funded project. What is maximum? These are all attributes which we find that they are manipulated. Are they are really representing the proper candidates is a matter of concern. We have tried it several. I had a committee of Dr. Paroda, which we looked into very critically in all these aspects. So what is ultimately is the decline in ratio of vacancies eligible candidate, high degree of variation in SAU performance, declining inter-NARS movement is another very important factor. We must have people coming from universities to ICAR and from ICAR to universities. I think that kind of inter sort of movement has to be a very important factor. Then lack of leadership in SAUs and ICAR level shall create a vacuum in RMP position, which needs and develop. Now, let us go to talent search of SAU mode. You will be surprised that this has become more what we call it as advertisement are regionally available. Recruitment is by and large based on scrutiny of biodata or FLA eligibility. NET mandatory in some, but not all. Lateral entries of associate professor, professor by promotion, if advertised from within the faculty. No major inter-university changes. Current entry level post available in SAU could be between 15,000 to 16,000 based on the total strength. Now, the whole problem with SAU entry is, over a period of time, it has become more state or region centric. I think if we want more exchanges between the people, our people, it has to be rather a broad base. Suffer from pressure from power brokers, because I have suffered. I come from both the system. I have been in the university for a long time, and then I worked in ICAR as director also. It suffers from pressure from power brokers in the region and unnecessarily interfering. less transferee in the system, as no entry examination exists in many of the SAUs. True autonomy does not exist, as the board is full of local politicians. Now, terms, and that is what I think is very bad. Now, Norm has already indicated the leadership in NARS is average to moderate, with a very few exceptions. Leadership lack risk-taking capacity, delegating powers, and situational leadership effectiveness. Pyramidal structure of leadership developed during Green Revolution period at discipline level, college level, SAU level is totally vanishing today. How to identify leadership skills, traits, behaviors, attitudes, and knowledge for science leaders? Serious concern for leadership at NARS at all levels, because it is not only ICR, but we are finding it even at the SAU level, there are serious problems which are occurring. Now, what are the some suggestions? Lead together in science and building team. Leader must be able to establish partnership, create environment for nurturing future leaders in the system, manage self-research institute, facilitate partnership and private change. It must inspire and build confidence, accessible for a decision-making system. Current leadership programs we have already, ICR has been doing everything which is possible. And one of these is NARS system of leadership. They get good training at the director level, ADG level, DDG level. There is also entry level team player, ARS people are also motivated. Middle level, there is a knowledge guidance and motivation. NARM is doing training program for all levels, but rarely SAU take advantage. What is not able to do is middle level training there in the SAUs, and that is Veji's problem. Another very important issue is investment. Research and teaching need to be different from employment guarantee scheme. Merit coupled with passion, highly necessary. Researchers engaged in a lot of non-scientific activities, still obsessed with food security, and hence 50% are engaged in crop research, 29% in livestock, and only 6% is fisheries, and only 1% in forestry. So these are some of the gaps which are important. The country has spent so much of crores of R&D, which is just 0.4% of the total income earned from agriculture and allied sectors. The expenditure on R&D has been hovering to 0.4% of GDP for the last 18 years, except in 2011, where it was 0.51. Compare it with developing countries, and you will find that we are not spending enough. Take, for example, Brazil. In almost, it is 1.9%. Wonderfully, China and also Japan, where they are spending a lot of money on the farm research in R&D of agriculture. R&D investment has grown by 26% in the last 7 years. But 90% share is going to salary. That is another part. Investment R&D is critical to raise capital intensity, technological upgradation. Long-term growth and doubling of farmers is not possible without R&D expenses. It is already known that return on investment R&D are as high as 0.3%, 33%. A single basmati cultivar like Pusa 1121 has fetched 15,000 crores of total basmati export of rupees 25,000 crores. Surprising that in spite of such glaring example, funds allocated to this sector are low. India need to triple its investment in agriculture R&D if it has to reach to anywhere close to China. I think a report of IFRI. This is a very interesting report, which I think, according to Gulati, the impact of agriculture R&D is greatest on poverty reduction. Per million rupees invested in agriculture R&D reduces poverty of 328 people, while it is 130, 42, and 10 respectively for investment in roads, education, and irrigation. Can you imagine that this is such a greatest impact? And therefore, we, I think, as a collective people must see that our expenses government allocates the sufficient. If we talk about ICAR, it is okay. At state government level, I am afraid that now it may be even less than 0.2%. It is accepted that the achievement in agriculture are due to technology-led growth. Today, what we see is the bumper yields, bumper crops, full godowns and everything. Why it is? It is because of technology-led growth. And also investment in R&D since Green Revolution time. Technology cannot be discharged without science research. And investment does not mean only salaries. So let us examine the facts of current policy framework. Defend science and not defund it. Always answers what religions cannot. I think therefore some suggestions for improvement. Very quickly I go through. ARS system is fairly standardized with two-tier examination free. Can this be extended by SAUs to select APs, scientist, extension worker? To avoid school recruitment, tap them young system to be introduced. I think CSIR at one time or DRDO started to look into this. I would also say that 25% posts need to be reserved for tap them young scientists, and they should be supported by ICAR in each universities of India. Entry level for norm to be extended as mandatory for SAU entry level. How lateral entry between ICAR, SAU, SAU, SAU can be enhanced through some administrative reform. Successive plans to avoid gaps in research management position in institution must be looked. Manpower planning for entry level recruitment based on long-term vacancy position. Today, I find that ASRB is doing a job, but it has become so slow that at one time you are now having 90 positions. I don't think it will take 2 years to fill up those positions. Two-tier system for the selection of RMP first, a preliminary screening consultative process. I think what's suggested by many of them should be applicable. Can be SAU positions of deans and director be chosen from centralized selection process? There was time when, during my time, there was a proposal that let all and deans of directors, 5 years tenural position like our director, be filled by ASRB. So we are already giving 15%, 25% reservation in the admission. Can the deans and directors also be chosen? Was one of the suggestions then. I think it can be implemented now. Free education from routine setup and allow reforms to SAU in the new education policy. They must adopt Model Act and allow functional autonomy. Can we remove all political people on the boards of universities? Otherwise, they will never improve. Develop independent long-term linkages with foreign institutions. ICAR SAU must shed away rigid rules and bureaucratic environment. Exchange teaching learning material within SAUs and promote e-learning system. Change we must. We live in a world of change. Change will ruthlessly destroy institutions and people who cannot and will not adopt. It is a world where today's winner will be tomorrow's nobody. To grow, we must and be prepared, jettison old habits and minds. I think this is my last slide. And I must thank that science, there is nothing like it. True science and not myths, that is more important. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to meet all the directors, at least verbally, through this mode. Thank you, Dr. Agarwal, for giving me opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Maisab, for this excellent talk, excellent data which we have provided. Yes, we agree, change is must. And the ICAR is always striving for the change. And if you see the latest changes which we have been made for everything, for the quality education, for the more relevant education. We have already constituted the 6th Dean's Committee and we have already released the BSMA. We have made a roadmap for the implementation of the new national education policy in the agriculture university system. So many changes we are proposing, and the latest change in ASRB also you can see. So yes, we fully agree for this. So thank you very much, sir, for your points which you have made. for this. There is one question, sir, by Dr. Rajender. I share system is often seen with persons having a lot of negative attitude towards the system. That is dragging down the productivity and good working atmosphere. There is need to include positivity and pride through intense training. How it can be achieved?
Pardon?
There is a question.
Regarding.
There is a question regarding. Mm-hmm. May I repeat the question, sir?
Yeah. Can you repeat?
ICR system is often seen with persons having a lot of negative attitude towards the system. That is dragging down the productivity and good working atmosphere. There is a need to inculcate positivity and pride through intense training. How it can be achieved? I personally do not agree with this statement.
I think
that we are having a lot of negative attitude and other things.
No. Already said in the very beginning. One of the finest system that we have developed is ICAR.
Yeah.
And it is doing a very positive job. All credit goes to ICAR. Only thing is now, what we are trying to see is that the State Agriculture University fold, our ICAR should increase. You have already done a wonderful job in education. Now you are already taking up a load of accreditation and you are now giving universities a sort of a challenge. Now they are improving. My point is that this positive attitude should now go strengthen the entire system of NARS. So I am 100% sure.
Yeah.
I said in the world, there is no better system than what we have developed in ICAR.
It is one of the finest and vibrant system which we have in ICAR. And you see the contributions when our Honorable DG was presenting in Parliament. They were so impressed, the parliamentary committee, and they were saying that they were not knowing that your one single variety has so much potential and so much export revenue being generated, and many more things in biofortified crops, you see, in fishery sector, in milk sector, in animal science, any science you see, it's a wonderful. But I'll not talk much about this. I will request our Honorable Secretary Dare and DG ICAR to give the chairman's remarks about your lecture, sir.
Thank you very much. At the outset, thank profusely Dr. Mai Saab for his his eloquent lecture. Not only that, we knew what ICAR system or SAU system has been doing or is doing. But more than that, Dr. Mai has elaborated on what should be done, how one should really plan for future. And his rich experience in managing the human resource in ICAR system and SAU system is clearly evident. Human resources are so crucial for building future in any field, and so also in the field of agriculture. So recruitment is an important component of that, but Dr. Mai has gone beyond that. He started with the educational system and how the Indian agriculture's education system is working and how it has contributed. This is very encouraging to see that the agriculture, research, education, and extension system in the country has been quite successful, as it was pointed out in the beginning. And how immensely it has contributed to not only just building human resource, but in the process, contributing to the self-sufficiency in agricultural production systems. And not only just field crops, but going to animal husbandry, fishery, and all aspects of it. Dr. Mai, I personally, profusely thank you for elaborating on many aspects and also providing your candid viewpoints and providing newer insight into the future action plan that would be quite helpful while we plan our future path. Teaching, research, extension education that you have coined as a tree is quite innovative, and we really appreciate that. And certainly a tree needs to be nourished, nurtured, not just planted, and so that it grows. Teaching, research, extension education in the arena of agriculture needs lots of support, and you have very rightly highlighted all those. You have not only focused on the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, ICAR, and how it should be actually managing its human resource, but also you have highlighted the State Agriculture University System and how they should be also coming out with very specific plans to strengthen human resource in respective universities. The Agriculture Scientist Recruitment Board, since you headed that, chaired that organization, and very eminently managed that, recruited a large number of scientists, and also supported recruitment of other staff as mandated. So that was a kind of era when prior to that, there was a lot of kind of gaps. And you not only filled the gaps, but also managed to advance the kind of recruitment process which was actually required by ICAR. As a result, the human resource in ICAR was quite well strengthened and nourished. The ASRB should certainly plan for recruitment, and it is currently slow, and that is true that it is slow. And slow, primarily the reason being slow was that the reform which was actually introduced in the structure and also in the functioning of ASRB. That took time, but certainly, reform could have happened, side by side along with recruitment continuing, but somehow that could not happen. And as a result, the recruitment process slowed down. And, during past 3 years, you all know that COVID also put the brakes and it further slowed down. So the situation, these two together has really put brakes, and we have been seriously, slowed down in recruitment. And that is creating problems not only today, but also for future that might be actually creating problems. So that is a fact, and we need to really accelerate. And now that the restructuring has happened, and then we have also the process in place, and COVID has declined in its intensity, and we should be able to accelerate the recruitment. And certainly ASRB has to accelerate and increase the pace so that the annual range of recruitment of scientists, as you have pointed out, at 150 to 350, that should be actually now taken up. We advertised more than 200 positions, and another batch is being prepared. So hopefully by end of this year, we should be able to advertise that. So around 600 positions are vacant at this point in time with regard to scientists. And, if we have another advertisement, and there will be another 200 to 300 positions vacant. So this is what this situation is. But more so, what you have highlighted is having more of talents attracted to agriculture. First of all, unless the talent is attracted to study agriculture and allied subjects, obviously there will not be availability of people to be recruited as a scientist in the form of talents. So the key lies in attracting talents to study agriculture and allied sector. And that is what we are promoting at this point in time. And digital platforms, online systems, which have been put in place, and students who are taking exams today, they are many times more than what was happening even 5 years ago. So close to 2 lakh people writing exam, so that is something which was not happening. That was in the range of 2,500 to 25,000 to 30,000. So that has increased many times now. And in fact, the emphasis on engineering as a subject has gone down because of various reasons, and many talented students are opting for agriculture. There were some states where already many talented students were opting for agriculture, and now the other states are actually doing that way. And when we look at the kind of JRFs and SRFs and also scientists coming from different states, that has also changed very significantly. The students the JRFs that used to come from states like Andhra Pradesh or West Bengal that shifted to Karnataka and Tamil, universities contributing to more students than others. So there is a change happening, but not all states, as you have rightly pointed out, are doing well. Not all universities are doing well. And so there is a great deal of variation with regard to talented students getting entry and subsequently, again, entering as a scientist in the system. So this situation that we have highlighted is true, but more so for the state agriculture universities. The recruitment system, as you rightly pointed out, is different. The regionality, the net requirement, which has not been made mandatory in several universities, and movement between the states or SAUs and other points that you have, are very true. And they are issues and these are certain really issues and concerns. And true autonomy, which should have prevailed in universities, is not. That's another important point you have highlighted, and I'm sure we should be able to address them. The unfortunate part is that these are all state universities and we do not have real control over them. We can be persuasive, we can be playing advisory role, we can suggest changes, and we can provide them a model act, but they are not really mandatory for the state agriculture universities to adopt. But then I do agree that we need to do more than what we are doing. In the context of new education policy, we have defined several things, and we expect that state agriculture universities will follow them. The Model Act we have prepared, we have changed, keeping in mind the recent developments. And certainly once it is approved, we'll certainly again circulate. And we would incorporate the requirements of the new education policy. And you know, then I would request that persons like you, and with your help and you know, your with your support, we should be able to really persuade the state governments to adopt and then implement a model act. And all these requirements, you know, should be met. For instance, you have suggested that if we can have a recruitment of directors or deans, you know, at the state agriculture universities through ASRB, and particularly for the positions which are related to the AICRPs or even other positions at the universities. If the universities can opt for those, you know, kind of mode of recruitment, and ASRB, you know, again, is mandated, you know, to do that. At this point in time, it's not mandated to do that. So we have to have a change in the mandate of ASRB, and then, you know, they can actually recruit them. So that is, you know, a very good suggestion and a point to really further ponder and then take it forward. Certainly, the long-term linkage of the universities with foreign universities is a very good point which you have highlighted. In fact, for academic purpose, we have freed universities from too many approvals, and you know, kind of a minimum approval system in place, they should be able to really do that. And in fact, it's now encouraged. In fact, almost, you know, they are very routinely entering into, you know, collaborations and MOUs with foreign universities. Certainly, they would be able to do that, you know, in future as well. ARS system for SAU recruiting scientists or, you know, assistant professors is a very tough call, and I do not know if the state governments have accept that. And you know, taking scientists through ARS examination for their universities and for with whatever quota for the states they want to have, so that would be quite interesting. And we would work on that and give suggestions to the universities, and if they accept it, that would be quite useful, I strongly believe, because in breeding in universities with regard to faculties, in actually affecting and impacting negatively the quality of teaching. So that is a very important point which you have highlighted. Manpower planning, which long-term perspective is a very, very important one. And not just 200 people, 300 people recruited per year, but which subject, and in another 20 years, how many in the universities, in the, you know, ICR system, keeping in view new developments, keeping in view the needs of the country, greater emphasis on certain areas like digital agricultural research platforms and extension platforms, and so on and so forth. So also use of data analytics or AI in agriculture. So keeping in mind the new developments and planning our you know, human resource in agriculture for future is very, very important that you have highlighted. And we have initiated, in fact, actually, we are planning to you know, engage with you know, experts from outside. So that we get inputs from everybody who matter, and in the process build this up. How do we actually reserve 25% of the seats to tap the youngsters, not through otherwise? That's a you know, difficult question, and we need to really deliberate on that, and then see, you know, how do we do that? The ARS system doesn't really, I mean, there's quite a bit of resentment already to have people through senior scientists and principal scientists, and because, you know, of several reasons, I'll not go into those. And, you know, at early stage, how do we really do this? It needs further deliberation and detailed analysis. before we go into it and accept it. You did highlight the funding needs for agriculture research, education, and extension system. And you know, I need not really re-emphasize the point, because that's well taken. And how much the other countries are investing, how much we are investing, and collaborating with the private and so on and so forth, which you have highlighted, is very, very relevant. And we would certainly plan for that. You have lastly highlighted also on leadership. And leadership, building leaders, leadership, and creating that environment future leadership to be braid at institutions of ICR and SAUs. I think that is a very, very important point, and I have been emphasizing this in all my meetings, that let's build tomorrow's leadership. And that requires sacrifice and vision on part of the current set of leaders. And the current set of leaders, if they are selfish, and if they are short-sighted, and if they don't really believe in sacrifice, so probably if they are not really inspiring, they don't really build tomorrow's leaders. So that is a requirement of a change in attitudes. So I'm sure, with a greater degree of engagement with today's leaders, we will be able to breed tomorrow's leaders in the institutions and universities. So people like you, I would request if you can go around and lecture the universities that how one can build tomorrow's leadership at the universities, supporting talents, or then nourishing them, not suppressing them, and encouraging them to flourish. After identifying them early, detecting early talents in them. So that would be going a long way in actually building tomorrow's leadership. So we will look into all this. In fact, the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav lecture series is in fact designed to have diverse viewpoints and also build future programs, policies based on these recommendations. So we have noted down each one of those, and we would certainly bring out a document on these 75 lecture series and highlight the major recommendations and in that what could be possible action points for us to implement. So these are all going to be done. So I once again thank you very much. There are many other points you have highlighted. I have only picked up some of those and need not to really repeat what you have said. And what I highlighted, there are very important points which you have said and on which we have to really work for. So these words, once again, I thank you very much for sparing your valuable time and providing, kind of a guidance to us from your rich experience. And hopefully we will be able to move forward based on the points that you have raised and build our future programs. So thank you very much. And thanks, Dr. Agarwal, for driving this. And let us give Dr. Mai a big hand. So of course, these online systems doesn't allow all these things, and silently we have to do that. So thank you very much, Dr. Agarwal, also for arranging all these. Now more than 35 lectures you have already organized. And we have heard Dr. Mangala Rai, we have heard Dr. R.B. Singh, we have heard Dr. Mai today, and several others. Stalwarts. And certainly as we go along, we'll be listening to many other, tall personalities, leaders and role models to guide us. So ICR would be enriched once all these are documented and taken into account for future. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your excellent remarks, for your excellent synthesis, and give viewpoints and apprising us about the latest developments. As Dr. Mai has rightly told, that change, I again repeat, the change is must. And as rightly told by our Honorable Sakshi Dare, that changes are happening. And the changes are happening for the positive change, for the positive attitude of the persons, which we all have now witnessed. So that's really a big change we are expecting. And we once again thank you, sir, for your excellent talk, excellent synthesis, which you have given today for the benefit of all of us. And you can see a large number of participants today, more than 450 at the one point of time, who attended your lecture. So you can see how people rate you and how they want to listen to your viewpoints. So thank you once again for this important lecture series. Please keep connected with us. And the next lecture is going to be by Dr. Chandrama Saha, President of Indian National Science Academy. And I'll just send you the details of that lecture. So please keep connected and always get benefit from this 75 lecture series of ICER. Thank you, sir. Namaskar.